Singles. He recorded 59 studio albums. He won 11 Oscars, 2 Grammys. But when we talk about numbers, nothing matters. Because it's about us and Frank's music. So just think about this. When was the first time? When was the first time you ever heard Frank's music? Think about it. I was about 6 years old. It was 1984. I know, sorry, I went to the game. Christmas Eve, we're going. My parents are taking all of us kids to my grandparents' house. And I remember we parked the car, we walked down the sidewalk, up their stairs, walk up four individual steps, and doo-doo. All of a sudden, my grandfather opens the door. Hello! And I get this smell. It's the smell of fried onions, butter. My grandmother's in the kitchen. She's cooking up a storm. My grandfather says, come on in. He says to my dad, you want a scotch? Not for you, kid. Come on in. I sit down, and on the old hi-fi stereo is playing none other than Bing Crosby. You know that tune? I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. You don't know the song, okay? No mind. Yeah, who's Bing Crosby? He sucks. Anyway. So after that record finally came to an end, I was like, play it again, Grandpa. Play it again. He's like, no way, kid. I got something better for you. So he walks away from the old scotch cabinet, goes down to the hi-fi cabinet. He's searching through the records, and he's like, nope. Later. This one. And pulls out. Ozzy Osbourne! It's not a joke. My grandfather had actually lost the jacket to his favorite Sinatra record. And he stuffed it in an Ozzy Osbourne jacket throughout the Ozzy Osbourne. And the reason why I know is because I still have this record. And as soon as he put that record on and he dropped the needle, I was hooked. Changed my life for the next 37 years. So it doesn't matter if you were like me when you first heard Sinatra at 6, if you were 50, 40, 10, 20, we're gonna go back in time tonight and we're gonna relive the magic of his voice, the musicians, the arrangements. So before I start, how many people were at our show in 2019? Okay, we didn't do a good show, I can tell. The crowd was pretty darn good, though. And I gotta set some rules. First and foremost, if you guys, tonight, if you guys actually wanna, like, snap along and clap along, do it. Number two, remember that this music was meant for dancing. So if anybody wants to dance, come down here, right in the front row, if you're shy in the back. And number three, obviously, if you know the lyrics and you wanna sing along, don't. Okay. I saw that guy in the back corner. He was like, ah, come fly with me. You guys ready to have a good night? Let's do this. Sing along with me for this song. At least this one song. Cole Porter, Nelson Riddle, Change the Face, American Music Forever.
I've got you under my skin. Deep in the heart of me, so deep in my heart that you are a part of me. I've got you. You try getting in. I've said to myself, this affair never can go so well. But why should I try to resist a baby I know so well? I've got you. Thank you. I'd sacrifice anything, come what might, for the sake a warning voice comes in the night of repents. Here's my
Adrian on the piano.
You make me feel so young. You make me feel like spring has sprung. And every time I say spring, I'm such a happy individual. You speak, I wanna run and play hide and seek. I wanna go ahead and bounce the moon like a toy balloon. You and I are just like a couple of types running around the meadow, picking up all those forget me nots. Feel so young. You make me feel like spring is sun. Want a fall flame to be flown. And when I'm old and gray, I'm gonna feel like you today. You make me feel so.
He's always yelling at you.
You!
Let's think about this for a moment. Let's think about how big Frank was. I mean, obviously you guys know, you've lived a life, you know the story. But, as I said, back in 1984, I came from a different perspective. And when I think about it nowadays, I like to think that Frank Sinatra was kind of like the first Justin Bieber. Right? I know you guys probably hate his music, but anyway. Here's the deal. By 1946, Frank Sinatra was doing something like 45 shows a week. Any given day was doing up to 100 different songs in a day. And today's money was making something like $3 million a week. Big deal. But he was young. He was young. And what has Hollywood and the music business taught us all about being young? Sometimes you don't make it. By 1953, Frank was barely selling 150 tickets. This gig he did in Chicago did very, very poorly. Actually, he probably could have opened for me. I'm kidding. No. Joke. I don't have my own avenue. But here's the deal. The best, the cream of the crop, always rises. In Capitol Records, they were like, we think we got something here with the guy, Frankie Boy. And they signed him to a new deal. By 1953, this brand new deal put him right back on top with his debut record was in. And I know a lot about that record. That was the record that my grandfather gave me. I told you about it before. That first song that I ever heard was Frank singing this next song. And I don't want to call it serendipitous or just luck, but when I recorded this song 25 years later, it gave me my first platinum record with Universal Records, so maybe things come true. Without further ado, here's that great song.
Thank you. Now, Ben Riley on the drums. So we've got it.
I know they say you're lonely. You cried the whole night through. Well, you can cry me a river. Cry me a river. I cried a river over you.
Spotify, and every time I catch her listening to music, it's like, I want to sing the same note. I want to sing the same note. This is like, we are part of the privileged few. And just when someone says, you know what, you guys are too hoity-toity for us, I would like to talk about some other people that are cool, like us, who love Frank's music. Bono and The Edge. Of U2. Love Frank's music. And I think it was like 1993, Bono did a duet with Frank. I've got Joy My Skin on his big duets record. And Bono, being a big fan of the chairman of the board, obviously said, dude, let me please write a song for you. Let me, let, let, I'm gonna, actually, you know what? I don't even need permission. I'm gonna do it. Please record it. He did that. Unfortunately, Frank died before he had a chance to record it. But the song wasn't lost. I think it was in around 2003, I got a call from my publisher that was like, hey, how would you like to record a song written by Bono on the Edge for Frank Sinatra? Exactly. I was like, I'm too busy, man. Seriously. And around 2004, I was invited down to Las Vegas, and it kind of started my whole career down here in America when I did this show called The Casino. Remember that?
Woo!
It was actually not only the title track of my debut record with Universal, but also the title song of this great show we did called The Casino. All that aside, all the accolades, as we all know, that all fades, and all we're left with is tonight and a song. I can tell you everything about it. I can pitch it everything. I can pitch everything to you, but in your mind, you either have to love it or you don't. So here it is. And just to begin, we're gonna start with a great introduction by my fantastic piano player, Adrian Frugia. Please take it away. Figure out
much we might have had. It's just two shots I made, one shot aside.
Bring it blue. I know this song.
A fur on my head tonight. And let me explain. I think it's because she's from Eastern Europe, and they dress up in furs, but she actually wanted me to wear a fox hat. And it happened on the night of the 10th when I was packing, and she looks at me and she's like, "Where's your last date?" And I said, "It's at Myron's." And she goes, "Myron's? Wear the fox hat!" Okay, fine, that's fine. All right. It worked in San Bernardino, okay? I'll deliver now. That's fine. That's what all the people say. You're riding high and people shot down to me. But I'm center, they're like, "Really? People go to shows at performing arts centers?" And I was like, "Yeah, there's actually about, 2 million people that live here?" And I was trying to explain this venue to them. I'm like, listen, it's like, it's kind of like Rockefeller Center. It's very, very cool. But the most important part about this is that the acoustics in this place are amazing. And I gotta tell you, when I first walked in, you could literally, you know, hear a folder drop. You could hear a hat drop. And I said, well, this is the perfect venue to do something acoustic. So, this is one of my very, very favorite songs. It was written by a guy by the name of Charlie Chaplin. And the story goes that he was on his way to Warner Brothers Studios to film something. He was with his son. His son was actually very, very upset that he was leaving him so soon, such as kids do. And he started to hum him this line that he had thought in his head. His son stopped to cry. And later there were lyrics put to it, which is this next song. So, Carl, if you just mute us all on stage, we hope you guys can hear us.
Happen lush.
A lady touch a lady for a score. It ain't fair, it ain't nice. A lady touch and wonder all over the room and blow up on some other guys.
I'm gonna sound this for you after. This is good. This is good. I'll talk with you after.
because you are special. This is like my favorite part of the show, and I hate the part of the show. They say all good things. And I can remember about 10 years ago. Well, no, Jesus, I'm forgetting how old I am now. I'm just being, it's like 2 years ago. I'm sorry. This is just before the pandemic. I was staying with some friends in Harlem. I was doing a gig down at Carnegie, and I got this Uber. And my driver, she couldn't have been more than 25 years old. And you know, we get in the car. My bed and I, we get in the car, we're kind of like talking with her. And she's being very, very polite. She's like, hey, where are you guys going? Why are you guys going there? We're going to see a show. It's like, oh, cool. What do you guys do? And we're like, oh, we're musicians. She's like, you're musicians? I love music. What kind of music do you do? I'm like, jazz, you know, like big band music, like Harry Connick Jr., Tony Bennett, Frank Sinatra. She's like, wow, Frank Sinatra, wow, who's that? This is not a word of a lie, this is true. I'm like, really, you haven't heard of Fly Me to the Moon, Country in My Skin, New York, New York? She's like, no clue. I'm like, I wrote those songs. I think they're gonna be a hit. She's like, really, can you play me some of your music? I'm like, yeah, here's a demo singer. So I get on my phone, and I plug in my phone to her car, and I get the Spotify app and start listening. And for 35 minutes, not a word. Just blasting the best hits of Frank Sinatra. We arrive at Carnegie, she turns around, and she's like, this guy's pretty good. I think he might make it. The jig was up. I had to tell her everything. Anyway, she was just like the perfect example how this music will not only be around forever, but it will be discovered forever and ever.
Amen.
And great music, like I said in the beginning, never dies. And I'll tell you about this. I live in Toronto, Canada. I'll tell you all about it. another guy by the name of Paul Anka lives just around the corner, about 4 hours just northeast of Toronto. Boy, he was born there. And he wrote words to a great, great French song called Comme d'habitude. And I close my set every night with this, because this song is not about how old you are. It's about how much you've lived. And think about that. What have you done? Where have you gone? It doesn't matter if you're 12, 17, 45, or 80. If you knew tomorrow, your world would end. Each and every one of you could sing these words with conviction and with honesty. I sang these words differently when my dad died. I sang them differently when my daughter was born. And every day that goes by, I sing it differently, like tonight. So, Las Vegas, thank you for coming here to Myron's. Pleasure to be with you. I'm Matt Dusk. Have a good night, everybody. Without exception.
Adrian!